Okay, so we're just gonna get that ready pretty soon. So yeah, that, I mean, Flipsip and Norm definitely did show a lot of promise in that match. Though I could see probably early on there'll be some of Google Frog's trademark gunship attacks. If we see Ravage coming at any point, that'd be just death. Although it looks like DSD is the first match. I should probably actually write what this is.
Delta Seed's dry?
Oh yeah, Delta Seed's dry. I don't even know why, but definitely that, yeah. Delta Seed's dry. I know. We have never seen it cast, but it is going to be cast now because that's apparently the first map.
That's a really weird pick.
I don't know. You can talk to Sponge about it. That's Sponge is the one who organized the tournament. Thank you, Sponge. Despite your questionable taste in maps, we are very much appreciative for you organizing this tournament for us. Well, for the community.
Delta Seed's dry. I think, yeah, it's a bit of an underplayed map. We could give it some more attention.
Oh, yeah,
maybe
right.
Introduce it into...
I'm sure it'll have its big break thanks to this tournament. I know the map maker worked really hard on it. No one's really heard of it, though. No one's given it its fair share, its fair shake, its time in the sun. But now that's going to change.
That's amazing how long I've gone since seeing Delta Seed dry. Actually, I'm surprised. This is actually deluxe version, so it's not the. This is the remake.
Oh, the one that looks pretty.
Not the original one. This is the prettier one, which actually doesn't play exactly the same.
Because we need more pretty maps. But anyway, yeah, this 22x14. That's about the same size as Nuclear Winter, I think. Yeah.
Heaps of metal.
I don't. 12 to 24 players, and we have 4. This is gonna be good. I just don't. I mean, like I said, I'm a bit confused. Anarchid's pointing out 0K, the spring game where Delta Seed Dry is underplayed because we weren't totally sarcastic back then. Which is probably not a bad thing. But yeah, it's because BA it's overplayed.
Yeah, it's the only map, basically. It's.
Yeah, I shouldn't say it's overplayed. It's exclusively played.
But I don't think it's this version anyway, so...
I think it's V5. Or V6 or some other one.
This is just a complete remake. It doesn't even have the same terrain, the same electric layout, so... It's more of one of those... It's more like one of those maps which is, quote-unquote, inspired by a Delta Seed Dry. When there are a lot of them, than it is like Delta Seed Dry at all. But this way you don't see the original Delta Seed Dry in our rotation. It's
well,
not in our rotation.
Yeah, I mean it looks like it's just Delta Seed Dry. It's not even deluxe, just Delta Seed Dry.
What's wrong
with the version, my mistake.
In the tournament post it does say Delta Seed Dry Deluxe Version 3, which is this one.
So I might as well put Deluxe in the map listing.
It's a bit of a shame we didn't get sort of round 2 and round 3, which are Archer's Valley and Trojan Hills, which are...
I know! Well, Trojan Hills in particular. Archer's Valley I'm a bit on the fence about, but Trojan Hills is my favorite map. Although Trojan Hills is bronze. Trojan is bronze. So it's not completely gone.
Okay. I'm actually a huge fan of Archer's Valley. It's one of my favorite maps. I think... Just the assortment of lots of flat areas so that vehicle play can be had, but plenty of hills where a boss can sneak up on, where they can sort of retreat up there and use their ability to sort of get around and outmaneuver vehicles. And it's also in a sort of nice size for 2v2. 1v1 it works as well, but it's just a nice size for 2v2.
I can see that for Archer's Valley. I just much prefer maps with very nice terrain and height contrast and such, and Archer's Valley is flat with a bunch of bumps on it.
Yeah, there's sort of a difference where there's like ramp maps where it's a little bit more like StarCraft.
Yeah, and I tend to prefer those maps. Probably for historical reasons, but yeah, things like Ravaged or Trojan or Intersection or... My other really favorite map. I'm actually taking a shine to Conquest of Paradise. That's kind of neat. And there was another one, too.
I think the flat...
Oh, Onyx Cauldron, maps, that's what it is.
Or maps with flat areas just... play out better because they're a little bit more predictable with the movement.
Know, maybe that's why I like the ones without that.
Yeah,
me too.
Like Sierra. For me, I think, you know, just like these slow sort of rolling hills, which are actually passable by most things, but add sort of a little bit more interest rather than just like strictly like ramp cliff, ramp cliff, ramp cliff. Because I think, you know,
no. Springs it doesn't need to be like this, but I mean, you have maps where everything is bumped, like the old Icy Run or
Melt.
Yeah, there Melt's are a couple a huge of those. Example of that. It just doesn't work.
No, that's definitely problematic. You need to have flat sections. It's just that I prefer it
yeah,
when
it's
there's
either flat or it's slightly
contrast.
No.
Although Trojan does work pretty well with rolling hills. That one does handle it pretty nicely, but even then it's still mostly flat. It's a very, very, very light curve across the entire thing.
Yeah, and also the hardness of the map really plays into
that's
this
true.
Favor
Trojan
of...
Trojan is pretty soft.
I think Trojan is actually mostly... it's really, even though they are sort of a bit sort of rolling, it still does have that sort of ramp and cliff structure where, you know, you have these big ravines. And
oh, it
like
does,
that.
Yes.
And Delta Siege Dry is another map like that where it's very ramp and cliff.
I mean, Banded Plains shows how to do cliffs in 0K. Because you have the angled stuff so that no one can get through normally, and you have the waters so that spiders can't get through the angled sections. So jump bots can, if you're handling it right, jump through it. But that's actually why I built Ice Coffee the way I did, with the ravines with water in him. That way I could control the units a bit better. And then Amphib got good. And then I had to deal with that at some point.
Bandit Plains is a good example. Yeah.
I don't think Amphib's dominant there though. So I think that it's nice to have puddles, pathable puddles that they can just sort of sneak into and things. Because I don't think they're so powerful that they're the natural or the only pick there, but they're a little more bit more viable than they are in a lot of other maps.
Oh,
where
what I meant?
Choice first.
You mean in Iced Coffee?
Yeah.
Oh no, what I meant was that when I made Iced Coffee, Amp wasn't used at all, so it didn't occur to me to even test for it.
Yeah.
That was
which
the
means
problem.
That, I mean, as long as I think there are certain holes that they can only get down from one side or something like that, things like that, where it's that's not great. But I think it works quite well with Amphibs. I mean, even if you didn't intend it that way.
Okay, well, the game is about to begin, or at least the pre-game setup phase is about to begin. Get going. Okay, so we have... Alright, we have match. Semifinals, round one. Well, semifinals, Group C, game one. Google Frog Aquanim versus Flipstep and Norm. So I expect to see something kind of crazy. Although, on DSD, I have no idea what to expect, except air.
I expect air too. But every single time I predicted air in a 2-2, I've been wrong. So.
And you didn't predict it last time. It's the one time you would have been right.
On a map that small, I don't know. I don't really feel like a map that small should have necessarily have an air start. Although, I mean, I can see the advantage of having a very close position doing a Raven rush.
Okay, I've probably got to adjust the cameras so that there's a bit more open space, so that, or it has a bit more of a buffer zone. I mean, you have to get in the way. Anyway, yeah, so this map is huge.
Yeah, I think that we will see, given how Norman flips it one last game, we will see air again from them, and I expect Google Frog and Aquanim to have a response to that. They did watch the last game, didn't they?
Yes, they were. They were sitting, they were watching, they were studying, they know exactly what's up. Although, is it just me, or is this nuclear winter flipped vertically? And with the height flipped?
All those big team maps like that, they're kind of based on Delta Siege Dry anyway. They're all sort of the same sort of structure where you have a hilly, cliffy version, then area, then you have the big, flat section. So they're all kind of like this, honestly.
And should also point out that there's massive metal spots in the center of the map, because that's not exactly obvious. But there are massive metal spots in the center of the map. And each player gets like 12 metal each. Wow. 12 metal each, easy. Google Frog going proxy, cloaky. Norm looks like they're going for an air start once again. Flipstep hasn't decided yet. And Aquanim also going for air start. So yeah, double air is definitely reasonable. Yep, Norm going for air, Aquanim going for air, Google Frog going for Cloaky. No clue what Flipstep's going for.
we see some interesting choices already here, where Ghoulfrog and Aquanim are choosing to do the pocket player thing, where they have one player in the corner and the other player ahead of them to sort of expand in both directions and defend them there. Whereas Norm are choosing to take advantage of the sort of cliff area as a defensible position, probably presuming that you should put one laser tower up there in the bridge to the north of him, and then that'll be fine, that he'll be able to defend himself. Yeah, because Flipsip's starting at lower ground. So they're not choosing to pocket him in the same way.
No, that is, well, in a sense it is a pocket because of the way the cliffs are laid out. We'll see how that plays out, though. Aquanim is going... Well, Aquanim's got the air factory. Everyone's got their factories up. Ghoulfrog going for one glaive early on. Just wants to poke and scout. Doesn't want to do any real damage. And swifts from both sides. Which, yeah, I can totally see how that's reasonable. Even though this is game one.
Obviously.
0-0 at the moment. And Flipstep getting their scouting forces out. Nothing really out of the ordinary for the opening for either player. Although, like I said, Ghoulfrog is going for a much less aggressive opening than one might go for. But still, it's fairly reasonable. And this map's bright.
Flipstep is morphing his commander. I wonder why.
Well, Flipstep, yeah, field radar module. That's about the only thing that looks particularly interesting about that. Otherwise, just regular beam laser beam laser econ comm.
I think you're better off with a constructor than an early morph on this map.
Yeah, you can just spread out far more easily, especially when you're just 2v2.
And now you can see how Ghoulfrog is going massive. Expansion macro mode with three constructors straight from the start.
Mm-hmm. One's already up. That one's not doing anything yet. I think it might be waiting for the dart to go away, or Ghoulfrog might be focused on something else.
Ghoulfrog hasn't even built any defenses. He's that focused on expansion.
And yeah. Aquanim losing the air war. In fact, possibly going to lose a crane. Hard to say though. Swift coming in here to try to take out the crane. Down it goes. So Aquanim losing the crane right off the bat. Norm is ahead here. Very slight early advantage.
Go for a crane like that, because it didn't work out. You could see how he could find a corner where it expanded and almost never be caught, because he'd be constantly fighting the enemy fighters one on one that fighters wouldn't have a chance to scout as well. But it just didn't work out.
No, unfortunately not. But it looks like Alchemist's not that far behind. They're going to be able to rebuild their Swiss. They're going to be able to get the protected zone going.
Flipstep doesn't even. Hasn't occurred to Flipstep that there are more constructors even further away from that spot he's scouting now.
Yeah.
He might be going past it, though. I think this is... Ghoulfrog needs to keep his constructors... Yeah.
Them alive, you'll be...
Well, they've been spotted out, though one of them managed to cloak in time, but even then, they've been spotted out. The knowledge that they exist is still there. And actually, looks like Flipstep is going to know where to go. Not quite. Had the intercept path and lost it. Well, of course, over to the northeast, that's still a problem.
Three Scorchers. They're being harassed down by the fighters now, which is good. So he did actually manage to kill one of them. Yeah, there were three, but the Swifts killed one. Three or four. There's two more coming in, so there's going to be four. That's going to be a really difficult force for Google's expansion-heavy strategy to beat back. But he's expanding behind himself as well. He could probably afford to spend another one of his constructors behind him.
And Glaive's coming through the center.
Expanding force is not working for him.
Glaives are going out through the center, trying to get through this. They should be able to break through this Lotus with a couple losses. But then again, Norm's already well aware of this. Actually, no, never mind. Norm's going to stop this with Swifts. Going to just deal a lot of damage here.
He's lost one Swift. The Glaives can fire back, and if you don't have enough Swifts, the Glaives will regenerate between your
runs. True.
So you need to focus fire, and you need to be... Yeah, here's the Swift in retaliation.
Yeah, that's going to stop the Raven that was coming in to try to deal with this.
Yeah,
however,
Norm
it still does force back.
Control. Norm has basically said, okay, I killed your crane. I think I have air advantage. I'm not going to use that to get further air advantage. I'm going to use that to try and get the bomber. And it's ceded air control back to Aquanim right now, so I don't think that was the best move by Norm.
No, but I don't think it's going to kill.
Really Google valuable have to bomber.
It's not a death move by any stretch. It's just a mild annoyance, especially given that the Glaives are coming in. Having a bomber is not a bad idea.
It's meant Aquanim's back in the air game. And he's harassing out the raiders, stopping the
Scorch
from pushing
up. He might even consider
right now?
Phoenix now.
Yeah,
if you're
Norm
facing
for Phoenix,
this many raiders, Scorchers, and you have air advantage.
Oh yeah, sorry, Aquanim. Yes, Aquanim definitely could. Yeah, what am I saying? Norm normally has like four glaives to deal with. Aquanim.
I think he's going to keep spamming Swifts, because they can, once you have a big ball of them, they can actually snipe out Raiders pretty quickly, individual Raiders.
Yeah, they're very generic.
The Ghoul's done his signature thing of putting ticks around everything, and he's using ticks as his primary defense, not static defenses. He's going to try and use that as an advantage to get more territory faster.
Mm-hmm. Although the Northeast is still a naked expansion, Flipstep and Norm don't know about that yet, but once they do, that's pretty quickly going to go down.
By the way, can you catch Swifts with a tick?
I think you can if they're close to the ground, if they're firing on Raiders at the time the tick goes off. But I don't think the tick will actually trigger on them.
Ooh, here we go. We have the tick is... Yeah, the tick only stunned out a single Scorcher. That's really bad for Google Frog.
Yeah, there's another one. Two more, actually.
And they're supported by a Lotus, so that should mean it'll be able to defend himself.
Yeah, but once again, if just one Scorcher goes forward as it did last time, that might not be... Actually, that might not do anything.
I think if one Scorcher goes forward, he might be able to kill it with his commander and the laser tower. So, I don't think Flipstep at this point has enough Scorchers that he can afford to lose them one at a time. But maybe if he uses darts...
Yeah, I don't think there's... Well, there are some darts in play. There's two darts exactly in play. Yeah. That could do the trick if it gets in fast enough. Although the tick actually is not... No, sorry, this Glaze moving forward, not the tick. So, Google Frog trying to even this out. And it looks like, economically speaking, both players are actually... Or both teams are fairly even. Although Google Frog and Aquanim are accessing. They haven't got any caretakers up yet. They have some constructors, no caretakers. They get caretakers up, they will... And Google Frog actually is... Sorry, Google Frog is pushing metal in. Aquanim is not. Aquanim getting some caretakers up to help push Google Frog's ground forces. Nice work there. I mean, the air units don't need it as much. Aquanim has air control. Or at least had air control. Still seems to. Norm just going for basic outside harassment. And has seen the expansion. Google Frog's expansion is well known. And
he
a
loses
small force
all his
in.
Fighters.
That's true.
Yeah.
This is very bad for Norm.
But there's a small skirmish in the middle of the map. And Google Frog came out rather all right on this, only losing three Glaives to losing, killing three Scorchers or even more, so...
I think Google Frog is doing fine with his base.
Yeah, and yeah, now he's got enough...
And those Scorchers are getting bunched up too much.
Position.
But it enables Flipstep to take more maxes in the center on the flat area.
And there's also darts going over to the northeast, try to take out this expansion. Probably won't do much, but still, will be able to do something.
It's not.
Yeah. If Aquanim reacts with his fighters, there's no way the darts can do anything.
Actually, the darts are just kind of hiding at this point in the forests.
Flipstep has been giving away quite some scorches for past minutes. Now there is a big ball of glaze.
Yeah, I mean, at this
he has
point,
one leveler.
Yeah, he's starting to bring in riots now.
Well, the problem is that Aquanim is pushing in all their metal into Google Frog's... They're pushing their metal into Google Frog's Glickabot factory. While Flipstep and Norm are working separately, and Norm is actually starting to excess as well, only having one caretaker probably should do the same thing. Just push one caretaker down to push Flipstep's ground forces out, because at this point, ground advantage is going to red team pretty quickly.
Territory advantage, I mean, you can still see that the blue team, the commander of Flipstep is already halfway up the map, heading towards the big high-value metal extractor. You can see that Norm's commander is very, very far. It's like 80, 70% of the map right now. So they are grabbing up a lot more territory. So Google Frog and Aquanim do need to do something, because Google Frog does have a stronger army right now, and Aquanim has very strong control over the air. He definitely has air control. So he is transitioning now into Ravens, which he'll need to do to snipe that commander expansion up the north, because Google Frog is not in a position to stop that.
And Google Frog switching over to Heavy Tank Factory, I'd say it's about the right amount of economy to do that. Although...
Flip has access to the first Big Macs now.
Yeah, Flip's got that. Well, getting a Stardust on it first.
Finally bombing out in the middle, they bombed Azus, but Aquanim's in position to kill.
I have to say, the airplay of Aquanim has been perfect so far.
Yeah, I think he needs to spot these Phoenixes coming up to the north, though. These Phoenixes are going to bomb out all of those wing jets.
Yep, they're coming in and over to the south. So the Phoenix take that out. The south we have the Scorchers, and the Zeus is going out. The Scorchers being pushed back.
It's too expensive for you to trade bombers against a couple.
Yeah, he's still going to kill them. Yeah, you can see that. Norm is trying to do is set up two razors, because he's trying to set up a safe zone for his air, so that he can beat the fighters and bomb with impunity. and one of these Phoenixes does get back to the safe zone, so that might have almost been worth it, really.
Flip considering is really consolidating the Sentinel with Stardusts and HLTs.
This was the fear, even though that Aquanim and Google Frog had an army advantage here, the territory advantage of Flipstip and Norm is being consolidated completely.
Yeah, it's turned into economy. At this point, Norm already has one of the high value. Getting another high value.
Oh, oh boy.
Flipstip getting, I think, the second high.
That lever is having a field day with the glaives.
Wow, five glaives already for basically nothing. The Zeus are totally out of position, too, to defend against this. Rather surprising, that. There is a Conjurer that's not going to do much, obviously. It's going to tank shots.
And yeah,
otherwise,
send it
not really do much. Oh, but still, but second level actually, behind that.
I don't know if that was deliberate, but actually that Conjurer tanking those shots meant those glaives could come in and kill the leveler within the leveler only having been able to shoot once.
Yeah,
that, do the same
that was
a lot of glaives.
That was definitely clever. Just, and I've mentioned it before, although I mentioned it in the context of the hovercraft, the scalpel. And the scalpel is a much more obvious reload time because it's like 10 seconds or something. But, yeah, the leveler makes sense.
Google Frog's built up a big force. He's doing his trademark thing of going hammers, which almost nobody ever does. But he's built up a big force of Zeus's. He's putting out Reapers now. So he's building a force explicitly to break this central position. He knows that the enemy's consolidated their territory.
And those Zeus's and three of those Reapers, that is a strong attack, and that is capable of running through that center position.
And there's a tick just for good measure in case they get counterattacked early on.
But he still wants to soften up those turrets with Mortis. I think he's better off with attack now. That's exactly
Phoenix
what he's doing.
Okay, so Phoenix has been sacrificed a scout. Two Phoenix sacrificed a scout out the entire base area. Google Frog is having to lose at the center as well, and Google Frog's hammers being spotted out. I think that's where the tick is for. I mean, the Scorch is going to want to kill the hammers, but the tick's going to stop them. I mean, everything's going to stop them. Zeus is going to stop them. The tick's going to stop them.
No.
The Reapers won't really stop them.
I don't think individual units in this fight really matter. It's about the group.
Yeah, but if the tick stuns out that group of Scorchers, that's going to be the big deal. And that looks like this is where Google Frog goes for it. Really starts to attack. And in Spider Factory, Proxy Spider over to the north. Chainsaw as well to the south, so there is a good safe zone here. For
I think Google Frog would be quite easily be able to break this middle, but they need some land forces towards the north. You can see that
he should pumping spam glaives into this attack now, together with what he has.
It's the spider. It's the jump factory. Aquanim's actually gone jump now, and he's making pyros and he's making archangels as well to try and stop the air attacks along the north. But I think that honestly, in this situation, Norm's spiders are going to be stronger against these.
Although
he's already raiding with fleas.
Thunderbird, by the way, Thunderbird coming in, stunned out one of the Reapers, and well, Napalm came in as well. And nice bait on the chainsaw, pulling in all of those fighters. Just a bait on that Napalm bomber.
Yeah, you can see that in the middle, you can see all these Zeus's are just ripping everything apart. They're about to take out the chainsaw. They're in danger. They're seriously endangering Flipstip's commander. Flipstip's commander's dead. The Reapers, if they push in now, if they focus it down, and the Zeus's are flanking. I don't think Flipstip's commander's going to last any longer.
Slight over.
It will be very hard
there.
To stop this.
Well, no, it's over. But that part's over, but still.
It was a really good idea there to consolidate and create such a strong force in the middle, but he did not have enough on an army. Google Frog focused on artillery, focused on assault, and just had exactly what he needed to just crack it down. But the north is now getting ripped apart by fleas. Because they didn't focus enough on
it. And there's an assault
this is
where spider
stopping. This is the naked expansion being torn apart. Not as quickly as I anticipated. It took about 8 minutes, but still. As soon as it was spotted, they were working to tear it down. And it appears they've succeeded. Or very closely. There are pyros coming for defense. But in the north,
pyros
are
not very good
in
defense. I'll save you with fire. Pyros are just, they set fire to wind generators and just blow themselves up.
Ah, thank you, pyros, baby.
We see four hermits coming in now too, which the pyros, they should be able to burn them down, but it's just a constant stream of spiders coming to the north.
Now, how
There's
are they going
ravens?
To stop this assault force?
Yeah,
this force of Zeus's and Reapers.
Well,
there are no skirmishers, just some artillery.
That's true. Which aren't actually firing to create a minefield. Why are they not firing to create a minefield? That should have been done prior.
Not that it matters much to Reapers.
It doesn't, but still, it would have been something at least. Would have been a slight.
Lots of glaives or darts should work fine. No?
So the south is going down. The north has been actually successfully defended. Well, not successfully defended. I mean, The north has been totally lost, but at least they're trying to retaliate. However, there is still an economic advantage.
Fleet without the geo, by the way.
Norman
how
Joseph
strong
are so
these
ahead.
Reapers are. These Reapers are just coming in and just ripping everything
well,
apart.
Okay, but
there's a really strong force of Zeus's behind it that this is just going to walk and tear through the
Zakdoth, Zakdoth, you're forgetting the Thunderbird.
It's just one?
It is just
yeah,
one.
It's not going to be enough. It'll be disarm them. It won't even stop them. I think a large part of the strength of these... we see a lot of bombers coming in, but these are just... These
oh,
are
yeah.
Just
nah.
They're
yeah,
going to
take out
gonna
one.
Matter.
Yeah, they don't matter.
It's good that they're there,
as well. But... He's losing them to the Copperhead. I think in this case, it's... Yeah, he can't even stop them. A large part of the power of the Reapers is actually just moving. It's not even shooting. Because they can just tank and walk through things, and then get to the other side and start hitting the economy, which is behind the defenses.
That is a point.
Yeah. This is such a strong push. This is such a strong push. And there needs to be some sort of anti-heavy here. There needs to be a large force of Ravens, if those Ravens instead of Phoenixes. Aquarium stabilizing the north now, as long as he can stabilize and just hold, Google Frog can win this.
Yeah, if they can stabilize and hold, though admittedly, it depends on how long that goes for, because like I said, Flipsip and Norm are ahead. And
yeah, they have
a fighter coming up. Ultimatum.
Ultimatum,
yes.
Yeah.
It's going to be a minute left. I don't know. I mean, it's a good choice if it comes up, but I don't know if it's going
to
come up. The only hope is that this geothermal plant explosion kills the forces here.
No, Google Frog's too smart for that.
Yeah.
But yes, one is not enough.
20 seconds. Let's see if he skirts around it. 15 seconds. Oh. 12.
He has seen it.
10.
And
nine,
I don't think it's going to... Is it going to last?
Eight,
it is going to last. It will
seven,
get up. It's close, though.
Five, no.
And it is not up. Is it up?
On.
Oh, it goes up to explode. That's all it does. It goes off like a bomb. That's all it could do.
He might have been able to hold that, stall it a little bit.
Yeah, with a good D-gun shot. Good D-gun placement where he's done it. But
yeah,
no.
I think he probably should have focused on just getting out a ton of Scorches. Because they will, I don't know, maybe we're just in the number. I think Google Frog just... They focus most of their army on the bottom. That was more consolidation of resources rather than particularly good army choice, because you can see Akronim sort of bleeding on the top, but he's able to hold by having air superiority and by having able to fight from the top of a mountain and being able to fight sort of close to his base.
Also
he's able to hold.
The thing that happened was that Aquanium wasn't spending all his resources on units, and he bled some resources to Google Frog,
yeah,
which
exactly
enabled him to get up. Him alone had a bigger army than Flip, while he had much more resources.
Yeah, he bleeding some resources and also building that caretaker. Instead of going proxy factory himself immediately, going a land factory, Aquanium just supported Google Frog, which allowed Google Frog to consolidate his power so that he's more powerful than Flipstep entirely.
Although
so it's very strong force, and it's perfect units for it as well, for a big ball pushed through the middle, you know, Zeus and Reaper.
Well, in general, this large open map doesn't work well if you want to make turrets and walls of pork. It works in 10v10, but not in 2v2, because you can get around usually. And it's what it happened, he flanked the defensive wall.
Although
I think it was a really good call to put it in that defensive wall, because he'd taken over 50% of the map and he needed to turn his territory advantage into a consolidated advantage. It's just that Google Frog was perfectly prepared to switch into exactly what it needed to take it, to wipe it all out.
Yeah, I think from that position, man, to get out of that, either Massive Scorchers get that ultimatum sooner or just
don't
worry about defenses. Like, just attack.
I think maybe the air player from the north coming down and helping on the lower ground, because that's what Aquanim was doing. It was with metal. He was pumping metal into Google Frog. But he was also assisting with air, while the player in the north was completely obsessed with taking that territory.
Yeah,
and he couldn't do it as fast as Google Frog could take the territory. So he needed to sort of shift his focus. If he had built Thunderbirds during that attack, instead of the Phoenixes, which were, I understand he built them for the Glaives, he's thinking, oh, it's Glaives, I need to stop that, but Google Frog is kind of switched out of Glaives, and he's always fighting with Phoenixes against enemy air anyway, so he's sort of losing some.
Yeah.
Well-placed Thunderbirds there would have been able to stall that, so that the defenses could shoot back, could slowly kill off the Reapers, and, yeah, at least slow it down enough that he can come up with a proper defense, like an an ultimatum and that, or a big squad.
That's where scouting would have come in. Like, just throw a dart to the wind. See what's there.
Because, or Swift.
Yeah, or Swift. Just know what's happening, because that's the thing. If they'd known what was happening, it would have been, you probably would have been Thunderbirds. Probably would have been some stuff. It probably would not have been anything crazy. Like a couple of napalm bombers, or just, they wouldn't have been stuff that didn't make sense for the situation. It would have been that was right.
Napalm bombers are a niche choice. I think he expected Google Frog to stick to Raiders and play the Raider game. It's a big map, so it's fair to just keep playing the Raider game.
It's build sort of a big
huge,
map.
Huge, gargantuan force of Raiders and just sweep through them. And yeah. Phoenixes are a niche choice because they will really destroy like a big, tightly packed group of units.
Gotta be honest. Oh, sorry.
It needs to be a very tightly packed group of really, really light units. Like it's therefore like if a Recluse Ball. Do you remember Recluse Balls when that used to happen?
Yeah.
Recluse Balls stopped happening because of the Phoenix, and they still don't happen. And we actually toned the Phoenix down because Roccos. Remember when Roccos were never used?
And yeah,
and
now they're the counter.
They became completely
factor.
OP, and now they're sort of more balanced and sort yep. of just a part of the game. That was because the Phoenix shelling them down, because these big AoE attacks sort of keeping them out. So sort of toning the Phoenix down in power a little bit allowed these big skirmisher balls to come out. But if they get too big, if you rely too much on Roccos and things, you can still get hit by an effective Phoenix. The Phoenix can still swoop in and just wipe that all out. But picking Phoenix in that case, I think he was gambling too much on Google Frog. On Google Frog just spamming Raiders.
Yeah, without checking first. The other thing I'd say is, I'd say Delta Sea's Dry doesn't feel like a big map. It feels like two small maps stitched on top of each other. Because there's
I can tell you, yeah.
Like the flat section feels like one map, and the hilly section feels like another map, and they feel like they're just next to each other.
Yeah, I think that this is one of the big things, is that in the north there, you can come down the ramps onto the flat section, and you can actually flank an opponent. So if he'd have done that, and he'd have like attacked the factory and forced the Reapers to pull back, you know, if he'd come in there with, I mean, he chose spiders because you're in the hilly area, but if he'd come over the corner with, you know, probably not recluses because, you know, they'd be vulnerable to air, but, you know, something to attack the factory.
Yeah.
The,
oh, by the way, your microphone's a little bit light.
I think you should have focused on the fights. You should have focused on the losing rather than trying to win. I can see that the why he'd try and be, like, I just got to win as fast as possible on the top.
Same problem.
And hope Google Frog holds. Is it still wrong?
Okay, try it again.
Is this better?
Nope, it's worse.
It's worse.
Oh, wait. Try it again.
Okay, is this good?
Yes, this is good.
Better.
Okay.
Okay, good.
Just want to make sure you're not drowned
out.
Sorry
about that. Yep, sorry about that.
But yeah, I see that. The Raider phase probably wouldn't last as long because it doesn't feel like as big of a map. You can get away with just a push. But now we're on to Into Battle, which is a much bigger map than it feels. Kind of the opposite situation. The 12x12 is
2v2,
like
you're playing horizontally.
That's true, so yeah.
Yeah, I think this is going to be interesting because you're going to have one player starting on the hills and one player starting on the flats. I enjoy this map mostly because it focuses around the gap in the center and the flanks at the sides.
Is
so,
your stream running, by the way?
Yeah, the stream's up.
Is
there's
it?
People watching. There have been people watching for the last 2 hours.
Why? Oh, wait, you're not streaming Twitch anymore,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, I'm testing Hitbox for the duration of October, and it sounds like people are actually having a good time with it right now. So I may, in fact, stick with it. I don't know. I'm getting some good responses from the chat. I mean, this isn't.
Can I chat without an account?
No. Apparently, there's a Facebook Connect thing that works, sort of, maybe. I don't know. Car Repair was testing it. It didn't work out very well. I have
evil.
No idea. Anyway, Google Frog acronym. East side map.
Yep. Looks like Google Frog and acronym are doing.
Another pocket play.
This is a much. A much cheesier kind of strategy where they're both going to start together and
just
it's interesting.
Push the factory? Why you do that with light vehicles is beyond me, though.
Yeah, I'm trying to figure this out. I'm trying to think, like, are they going to go Pyro Scorcher? Is that... Because presumably Acronym's going to get the Scorchers... The Scorchers going to come in
and
take out...
Oh, there is Tailbug Factory. I missed that.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, that makes a bit more sense. Sorry, I thought they were going to just try to push that light vehicle factory, put all their metal into that one factory, and that wouldn't make any sense.
Yeah, I'm not sure. It looks like they're going to do a strong raid. What they're going to try and do here, I suspect, is they're going to expect the enemy to start spread out. Because that's been... Yeah, that's been what Norm and Flipsit have chosen, generally. And... Yeah. I guess they're going to... This relies very much on Flipsit starting in the north. If Flipsit starts in the north with those three metal extractors up in the upper left, Google Frog and Acronym are just going to focus all their raiders on him and just kill him right at the start.
Although it looks like Flipsit and Norm are going for a double raider, according to chat. They're expecting Acronym to be separate from Google Frog, but they are going for double raider.
They might be thinking the same thing. Ooh. Yeah. Oh. No, this is bad.
Oh, boy. Flipsit at the north. Google Frog and Acronym at the south. Oh, sorry, at the north. What am I saying? That's east, not south. Everything's rotated 90 degrees in my head, apparently. Don't worry, I'll get more insane as the night goes on.
Eventually, after enough sanity, you'll get it right.
Yeah, eventually I'll just loop back around into complete normalcy.
Oh, So Pyro Slasher? I can see that. And he's going to push with the Battle Commander? Oh, yeah. He's pushing with Rock Up, which is his Rocket Commander. So he's going to do a Geyser Planes style Slasher Rocket Commander push, supported by Pyro Raid. And he's scouting out the position now with the dart, and he's going
to
find him.
And Norm exactly doesn't realize Acronym is not to the southeast. Norm expects Acronym to the southeast, which I'm not sure why specifically the southeast was expected, but yeah. Now they realize, oh, by the way, players are next to each other. Good luck with that. We'll see if that works with Scorcher Glaive versus Slasher Pyro. Scorcher Glaive is an advantage at the start. Like, very, very early advantage. It'll come down to how it's played, but I think they'll be able to survive. If they survive long enough, then...
Nothing here. Where could it be?
It looks like Google Frog is doing more. Is doing a defended expand with his slashes, sort of setting his slashes up in position and slowly defending and expanding, putting a laser tower in the middle to cut off any reinforcements from Norm or counterattacks probably.
Although admittedly, Norm's already gone round. Admittedly, they did go round and then they went back up to where they don't need to be.
Oh boy,
that's a
here
divorce.
We go. Acronym's Pyro's already taken out a Scorcher.
He has a right cannon on that commander. Hurry!
Keep messing up the sound.
He needs to jump away. Acronym needs to jump his Pyro away.
He
took out the Scorchers.
Yeah.
These Pyros are really taking out quite a few Scorchers. Here we see a lot of Glaives coming through onto the Battle Commander, but the Battle Commander is assisted by a laser tower in the middle of the map. Should be able to take that out fairly easily.
Again, down to 70% damage. The laser tower is going down, though. The Glaives are just avoiding the Battle Comm completely. Good choice, Norm.
Right call,
that's exactly what needs to be done.
But he still lost a lot from that, didn't he?
Flipstip is not microing his Scorchers against the Pyros. Which cost him three Scorchers. And he could have killed at least one more of those Pyros.
And the Glaives. The Glaives could go and kill that Slasher. Well, they could have. It's too late now.
They've
gone straight for it.
Slashers are really strong against Glaives. I mean, it's possible they might have been able to get
in
there.
It would have Razor's Edge thing. I think it would have been Razor's Edge, but it would have probably worked.
I think with the Mason there, if he was smart enough to repair it or something. You can see Google Frog's now trying to... He's pushing up with his slashes in the north, and they're sniping out the Scorchers. They're really pushing Flipstip hard. Flipstip probably doesn't have much longer to live.
Probably not, but at least Norm is taking advantage of that. Although at the same time, once again, Norm getting hit by that Lotus and going for the Lotus directly.
Yeah.
And Norm could avoid the Lotus in this case.
Yeah.
Norm doesn't actually have to get to it.
That Google Frog's not even using his commander. Solid. He has his commander with the rocket just in case he needs to use it, but he realizes he doesn't even need to. He just needs to secure this area of reclaim with a bit and secure that mountain pass, and it'll be fine.
But it's not secured. There's a ramp up onto the left side or the northwest hill. There's a ramp up and a ramp down that avoids the Lotus entirely.
Yeah, it slows you down a little bit. Yeah, but this is the route Norm's using to reinforce right now.
Oh, come on, Flip! Use the commander. You morphed it, but you haven't used it against Slashers nor against
Pyros. That's
a riot cannon, too. Yeah, this is just...
Ravager is the right choice, though. Ravager is allowing him to stabilize. That plus his commander should allow him to stabilize.
Yeah, the commander definitely looks stable as the pyros.
He's not using them at this together.
Although, to be fair, the slashers are pretty dangerous when it comes to commanders. Like, the easy way to kill commanders is a bunch of slashers.
But you can take fire for 10 seconds and retreat, so the refugees can get even closer.
That's true.
Yeah.
But now there are even five of them.
This at least pushes the slashers back, and the ravagers are faster, so even if they can't catch them, they can pull back fairly easily and not take any guarding damage.
This is giving him a couple of seconds.
What this is giving is Norm the opportunity to naked expand as aggressively as possible.
As is being done, although admittedly not quite totally, one of the conjurers gets caught out. Slasher does see it scouting out to the southeast side of the map.
You'll be surprised to see how strong slashes on attack move are against the flanks, where the expansion usually happens. You've seen LT, it stops, starts shooting, you don't even have to look at it.
Mm-hmm. And it looks like
three ravages.
North side is getting hit again, but the slasher is being pushed back once again. Akron's commander, however, is far forward, and it looks like that missile launcher on a bombard comm.
None of the slashes died.
And none of the ravagers died. Overall, no change. So a slight territory pushback.
Roccos are being flooded up by Norm onto the hill, which is, they get sort of getting into position to defend Flipstip, but they can also probably pounce on Google Fox Commander.
I'd say the pouncing is probably the more likely approach. At least
but they lost the window because the slashes are now in position to cut them off.
But however, at the same time,
the ravagers in the north. Yeah.
So at least Flipstip and Norm are keeping their options open all the time. That is really good of them. Nicely played of them.
Yeah. Those Roccos are getting cut off, though, which is really bad for him. He's sending this really long, circuitous route over the hill to try and defend. And it's not working out. He's just losing them one by one.
And the Ravagers going down, too. One of the Ravagers already down in Akronym's territory. The other two having to retreat. Meeting up with some reinforcements, but not being built fast enough. However, the Roccos are running straight into the Slashers. That is unfortunate. Losing two Roccos, three Roccos for free.
He could afford to have had it if he built his Roccos up and wasn't losing them piecemeal like this. If he could enfilade, go along the line, come down to the side of the hill, push through them if the commander wasn't there, maybe, because I think the commander would stop that from happening. You can attack into a slasher line if you go. Yeah.
Which is another mistake. There's no point. They need units more than anything, not a morphed commander in the corner of the map.
Yeah, I think Norm does have a caretaker. I don't know why that Norm commander is being done. That's just wasting resources.
However, Norm and Flipstip do have the better economy at this point. Much better, actually.
Yeah, but it's not going to help. I mean, Flipstip is not caretaking. They're building a caretaker right now, so it's just about to be done. But they have been caretaking for a while, so they've been accessing. And Norm is morphing when they already have a caretaker up. They're already using all their metal on units.
Flipstip has his own slashes now, and he's attacking Google Frog. This might work out. They see all the vehicles move to the south, and now the counterattack from Flip will be very strong. If you use the commander, the Scorchers, the Slashers, the Ravagers, that's dangerous.
Google Frog and Akronym have two pyros and two Ravagers now, which is just tearing apart metal extractor after metal extractor in the base. And they're getting into if those pyros get into the wind generators, which is what they've done, they're going to tear this apart.
Yeah, there's not much to be done there. It looks like there's going to be one last ditch effort for Flipstip and Norm to try to take this game back.
Yeah,
but their economy advantage is down.
They stabilized really well against a very aggressive attack on Flipstip. Flipstip did an excellent job, but Google Frog has now switched focus back onto Norm's naked expansion, where Norm had sent all his forces north, lost them piecemeal, and now he's having his base ripped apart.
Mm-hmm. And those forces in question are just completely out of position, too, trying to take care of a single pyro. Rather than, say, taking care of Google Frog's commander or try to get rid of the slashes while they're still moving. They've stopped now. Window's gone.
Now we see Flipstip moving. He's scorched back in order to try and defend Norm. So they're really reactive.
The Roccos, no!
Yeah, I was about to point out this is going to happen because the Roccos are getting right in the middle of the slasher line and getting right in the middle of the slasher line. Not even the sides of the slasher line to take it out advantageously. But the middle, where the slashers are at their biggest advantage.
You can see they're finally firing now, and they're finally line on line, and they're actually doing all right. They're not so bad in this position. It's the free damage they're taking when they're just out of range, which is the problem.
Yeah, although admittedly, line on line is not ideal. You want a T-crossing.
It's not. No, definitely not. And it, they can actually sort of assault into a line, but it's just you can't afford to have them sit there on the very outside, just out of range. You can't afford to take all that free damage. And a pyro just took out the Norm's factory.
Well, okay, that will bleed all the resources to Flipstep. Flipstep can put out an extra nano in anticipation.
Although, Flipstep can't... Yeah, Flipstep should... Well, I don't know, because the thing is, Norm is probably the one who should put out a nano for Flipstep. It's probably get a character graph for Flipstep just to push that much more metal in. Because Norm is reclaiming a bunch, not really building much. They've lost their factory. They are building another... They have no caretaker... No, they have no car repairs nano lathe on their commander. Building the spider factory, which probably is going to go for Recluse and Hermit, I would think. Something that comes to mind. Although, the north side, there's actually a pretty big... A pretty rush in by Flipstep. Dealing some damage to Akronim's commander, not going to be
if you can get that commander.
Oh yeah, if you get the commander, that's a third of the economy down. And actually, they will! Down goes the commander, down goes a third of Akronim's economy. Google Frog might still make up for a while, but Akronim being forced back just that much more. While Norm is building up... Oh, that spider factory is up in about a minute. Although, mostly because of Morph. So, Norm really focused on Morph.
He's a level 3 now with beam laser, light particle beam, field radar module, high power servos, personal shield, lavazard arrest device. Yeah, it's a bit
all
of
the
a
special
mismatch,
ones.
Isn't it? Yeah.
Where's the cloaking? There's no cloaking. That must be level 4.
Yeah.
The personal cloak and area shield on level 4.
Yeah, I can see why he morphed with having his factory down. You know, he has nowhere else to spend his money, but I think the level 2 morph was a little bit... Yeah, it cost him too much. He should have built more cons, expanded more, then built some defenses on them, got a heavy laser tower up. If he'd gotten a heavy laser tower up, that would have completely stopped the slasher push. And he put it in, if he put it in an important area, such as guarding the gap in the middle, yeah, he would have been able to stop this. I don't think Rocco's have been the right response.
No, but now we're going for Hermits.
And he's losing more of them.
Are a bit of a better response, I suppose. I mean, they're... Let's get the numbers up. They have the tanking potential, at least.
Yeah, you can see this is like 1v4 with the slashes, and it still managed to take one out. So it's not a bad choice.
Yeah, if the Hermits can get bunched up a bit and get a few of those, just get those out. And now we get into the Wolverine part, which is the most annoying sound in the game. Seriously, Wolverines are psychological warfare. The sound of their minds is repeatedly hitting the ground, just grinds you down when you hear for several minutes in a game, in a row.
Yeah, F6 really works.
You'll have to ask Google if you can change that. We see Flipstep's really coming back though now. I think they are stabilizing. I think this game is still in it.
Not over. Flipstep has stables for a while actually, especially having taken out Akronim's commander. That was a huge blow. If they can take out Goofrog's commander right now, which I don't think will happen, it looks unlikely. No. Goofrog's porking up a lot. But if they do manage to take that out, that will pretty much nail it, because Goofrog will then be at 8 metal or so, and already we're seeing a lot of damage in the center of the map, in their base.
I think Norm is really pouring Hermits into this when you need to gather up a ball of them. If he's going in piecemeal like this, he needs to go in with his commander at the same time, do some damage, jump back out, because he's got a shield and everything.
Yeah,
he's got auto repair and a shield.
Lazarus,
he needs
to
go in, do some damage with his force, pull back, and it's okay if he's losing a couple of Hermits every time he does this, but right now he's not using commander for anything. He's just using him to build some defenders.
Okay, now
which
commander's
is
moving
be useless.
In. Well, commander's moving
into quite okay.
Reclaim.
Yes, access to the Vrex.
Which is.
And he's
not
denying
a bad
the Vrex.
Idea.
Otherwise, that commander of Google Frog would be getting those Vrex.
Yeah, that's a good idea. Definitely does make up for the loss of the Hermits. And actually is still allowing the push, because the commander getting
shoot,
close up just, is attacking.
Don't reclaim, shoot the laser turret and get out.
Yeah, he's not going to be able to break this heavy laser tower, though. Not with Hermits.
No, of course
not. This many.
Although it looks like we're just going to see Lazarus up the Hermits. Not going to be fast enough, though. That commander's at 50%
that's
health.
Clever. It's clever, but he's already on. He's got so much metal. Mm-hmm. Yeah, he's. You can see how fast Hermits are now coming out of the factory. He's replacing them as fast as he built them with that reclaim. It's a good idea. He needs to build another nano tower
and
then
and
do that
exactly
again.
That's happening. And yep. Over to the north, we have levelers taking on the pyros as they want to do, and enough slashers to even. Well, actually, Flipstep's almost in the opposite position, or same position as Google Frog, but on the opposite side. Building
Gauss
turret, though, surprisingly.
Wow.
Yeah, I've noticed those have been built a lot more recently. You see one or so every couple games, as opposed to zero ever. But yeah,
I can see why he built them versus slashes and versus Wolverines in particular, because they're artillery resistant.
Mm-hmm.
But here we see some hermits. Yeah. The hermits are actually going in.
The hermits have pushed in. More replacement hermits are coming up. Ball of four hermits is a pretty good number. Although the stinger is doing a number on them.
I think he's playing this. He's playing this. He's clearly done this before. He's playing this Lazarus style, where he's like, "I have a Lazarus device. I'm just gonna suicide my hermits and just keep resurrecting them, so I have an endless ball of hermits going over and over."
Surprisingly, not resurrecting the pyros on top of that, though.
He's morphing again. I'm not
to level four. What does he want?
I don't know.
I think he wants more. I can look up his character or his user page. He has more. Nanolate.
That might be the case, because if with more nanolays, of course, the Lazarus device gets a lot faster.
I think that's the only thing that would work at this point, is more nanolays. I can't see anything. Unless he gets like some huge range boost or something, you know, that's going to allow him to use his commander offensively in a situation where he's not. I mean, against a heavy laser tower, which
basically can't. Oh, and Flipstep loses their commander, or just about loses their commander. There we go, now loses their commander. Down it goes, takes out three
raptors. The maximum damage you can get on those...
raptors, yeah.
Yeah, I don't think that was the...
The Raptors are going, being forced to retreat. That was a huge blow. And Norm's commander moving forward, getting rid of the HLT. Google Frog finally morphing their Rock of Commander. And it's not even going to be up in time. Norm takes it out. Light Particle Beam plus Beam Laser finishes off Google Frog's commander without issue. So despite the loss of Flipstep's commander, Blue Team is still ahead.
He
might lose his left again. Gets the Pyro.
Yeah, Pyro to the south taking stuff out.
Of nanolays, which means that he can reclaim this, resurrect it, whatever. Now, he finally used his commander there, and it's paid off. I'm fully in support of him having Morphe's commander now, because it's really worked for him.
It's worked.
It's broken
out
entirely.
It has worked, but that was cleverly done. I mean, the thing is, of course, commanders you can't just use them willy nilly. However, the southeast side, Aquanim still has it. That's still the ace in the hole that Google Frog and Aquanim have, and Google Frog switching to air. Though that's going to be tricky to make work. Ravens are what's coming up, which makes perfect sense. Yeah, not sure how well it's going to work. I mean, at this point, it probably will work fairly well. There's no anti-air right now. There are a lot of Hermits, though, and quite a few Venoms coming up on top of that. Yeah, Hermit, Venom, Hermit. That's the
Norm is getting a ton of metal.
Oh, yeah. And turning that into army very quickly. I mean, 40 metal into the factory all the time. As the reclaim comes up, there's enough power to support that. A caretaker being built up just so the Norm's commander can move forward. Just keep on going. Because really, why not? With a commander like
there's
that,
three
you
scorches,
want forward.
Three scorches sent in to deal with the the south, but they all just ran past the laser tower without shooting it. So only one survives, managed to creep away.
Took out a metal extractor in the process, but yeah, not the most useful thing. However, a Venom is coming in, and that should be much more useful. No, never mind, it's going to the north. My mistake. Norm just doing select all, move to north. Just line moving to north with all their forces. Don't even care anymore.
Poppy's by Aquanim, which I think is a relatively good idea. It's really, really good for reclaiming all the wrecks that have been created, but it's terrible against Wolverines.
And it's also not going to do particularly well against Hermits. Like, just with Venom support, they're not even getting shots off. Or so
this is a massive
shots
spider
off.
Ball. At this point, they need, you know... Something like roaches would be really strong here.
If they had it, but they only have a scuttle. And scuttle's way too expensive to be worth in this case.
Yeah, something else, they could go for dominatrixes to sort of slowly skirmish them back, but they don't have enough room for that anymore. Yeah. Maybe they can get something done with these ravagers, but they don't have any defenses. Yeah, they're collapsing really fast.
And the southeast has been taken out, basically. All the mexes are gone. I mean, the southwest is also getting taken out from time to time. Aquanim coming with a pyro, dealing with that from time to time, but not enough. The air factory up, but no Raven up yet. 20 seconds left, and that's going to be 20 seconds too long as the Hermits basically just come in for the kill. This is it. Take out one of the Masons. That'll slow it down a bit. Take out another Mason. That'll slow down even... it won't even slow it down. Never mind. Google Frog doesn't even need those Masons. Full power from the factory. Nice placeholder use there, but there's no pyro support. Hermits have to deal with this. Raven is up, but it's really not that big of a deal. Although, actually, no, quite a few of the Hermits go down. Actually, there's a lot of Hermits that go down. That's a big blow.
Yeah.
That placeholder working out nicely, but even then, there's still too much force coming
over.
In.
It's over.
Yeah.
Nice comeback.
That was excellent.
That was an excellent slow stabilization followed by just a really strong push by
Google Frog.
Norm
didn't,
is what won that.
Google Frog switched his focus to the center of the map with all his vehicles, the slashers, instead of finishing Flipstep, what was their initial idea.
Yeah. And also,
and they allowed it.
He had to deal with Norm's Naked expansion. I think it was wise to flip his attention, but
overcommitted.
Sort of. I think the Wolverines, using all those Wolverines against continuing to build up this big Wolverine pack, and then trying to use them against Hermits and level 3 Commander, it just didn't work, did it?
No, and the thing is, I think it was just overcommitting to that, because the Commander was there was HLTs, there was LLTs, there was a bunch of, and all the Wolverines, like half a dozen to a dozen Wolverines there. The Naked Expansion Destruction was fine, but after that, Google Frogs seemed to try to consolidate themselves there, which is way out of position from where they started, because remember, that was a pocket start. That was a corner start. They didn't have any support over in the southeast side. They had no control of the southeast side whatsoever, so they were relying entirely on the northeast. They just had no influence. They had nothing to pull in.
Taking out Norm's factory was a really, really strong move. I really like that. I thought that you know, it flipped it around, but then a commander drops on this side, a commander drops on the other side, and that was Norm. That was having stabilized the game, then Norm just using that advantage. I was really worried that he wasn't going to use his commander there, and then he was just pouring in Hermits, but it worked out really well for him, surprisingly well for him, actually.
Yeah. Also, small update for the tournament brackets. Gazi Black Duchy beat Dancer and Exponent 2-0. We'll be fighting against Anakin and Lowry after this game. After the next game, after game 3, because we are going on to game 3, Google Frog Acronym. See what they can do, see what they pick for maps. I'm guessing Comet Catcher, because that's just, you know.
What they do?
That's just what they do. Then Ditrino, the cheese was too weak. Yes, indeed, we need stronger cheese. I suggest Edam, but I don't know if that's strong enough. I mean, Bree's kind of a light cheese. Actually, blue cheese, Gorgonzola. That's what I suggest. Strongest cheese that comes to mind.
In China, I learned about a new stinky food, and it's called stinky tofu. And it makes blue cheese smell like roses.
Oh my.
I kid you not.
Although, I gotta be honest, I had Gorgonzola once on a pizza. I didn't know what it was at the time. And I thought, this tastes kind of weirdly sweet and sour at the same time. Not sure what to make of it. And then I looked up what it was and like, oh, that's why. Okay, I'll go for different pieces this time. Yeah, there's this semi-fancy bar or semi-fancy pub and grill a couple blocks from my work that I go to regularly, and they have, like, it's weird. It's like, it's a pub, but it's also in the middle of a fairly cosmopolitan city. So you have this, like, it's pub food with a sort of high-class gourmet touch to it. So you get things like Gorgonzola on pizza.
Yeah, it tastes nice on pizza. But it looks like, something very dirty.
It looks
if you put
like
it in
clams.
Food.
Really? Because I thought it looked like clams.
If you put it in a dish or bake it or in a sauce, everything becomes gray.
Okay.
And it's as if, yeah, it's some sort of drap, some sort of mud. But it tastes good, but it looks and it smells horrible.
Yeah, because on the pizza, it looked like clams or mussels.
Yeah, it kind of keeps its structure if you just put the pieces on the pizza. If you put it through pesto sauce or spinach or something.
Yeah. I mean, that's the pizza I normally get is actually a pesto pizza. Yeah, it's really nice. It's got like pesto drizzle on top with, actually, the pesto sauce in the middle. It's balsamic drizzle on top. And it has, I think it's chicken, I think that's the main meat on it. Anyway, really good. So yeah, I'm totally digressing on cheese. But yes, they should have used blue cheese. But unfortunately, they were the red teams. So that didn't do them any good. Well, Flipsim and Norm, yeah, they pulled that out. So I think the only issue was that, actually, I think the big thing was that Flipsim actually had a lot of defensible position. I mean, they were coming in, like, Akronym didn't have to, but they came in from a choke point. That north side could easily have been just taken out if they had gone through the center. I mean, it would have been a bit tougher because they would have had to go uphill. But at the same time, they would have had much more spread. They would have much more space to work with. And they would have had slashes on the top of a hill, which is also good. But anyway, we're going Bandit Plains from the looks of it. So we'll just get that set up. And hopefully I'll remember to actually switch the sound over next time the game starts. Alright, so Bandit Plains we were talking about before. Very, very cliffy. The only map I know of that actually legitimately stops things from moving around. You guys still there?
I'm here. Can you hear me?
Yep. Yep, okay. Sorry,
I wasn't sure because I couldn't hear you guys. So yeah. Game should be starting soon. Oh, Flipstip is apparently going to get something to drink. Which sounds like a good idea, so I will do that too. If you guys want to keep just talking to the audience, feel free. I'm assuming you guys have the chat window open so you can see what they're saying.
Yep, sure. I think that was like that last game was like one of the strongest I have seen in a while. I think it's really interesting though how the commander worked.
Yep.
Because I really didn't expect it to work that well. I was like, oh, this is a bad idea. You can't get close to the enemy commander on the HLT because it'll die. And the chat's still talking about cheese.
Yeah, well, Dutch cheese. Doesn't smell, tastes good. It's more of a solid cheese.
I can't eat cheese. I can't eat any cheese at all.
No.
It's terrible.
Allergic.
Yeah, no, it's not lactose intolerance, it's just cheese, specifically. My life is unending misery.
So bad. So sad. No.
Avocado. Fantastic.
Ooh. So it's it was the first game, right? Or the second? I forgot. It's the second. The first one was on
Delta Sea.
Yeah, this is the third one. So that was the second one. Yeah. Detrino's saying in chat that Norm had dozens of options to win and that the commander was the weaker one, saying that actually Norm had like a strong economic advantage, I think he's saying. Yeah, he's saying
they did.
Norm's like, eco is so far ahead that he could have chosen to pour hermits in uselessly, to morph his commander and then not use it until he's almost level 4, and to do all these inefficient things, which really just won on eco.
Yeah, I think it really shows how powerful the eco
like,
is.
No, the hermit push really worked. And it's like, it's because Google and Aquanim did a pocket thing where they're starting together.
Yeah,
and
they're easily surrounded.
They're trying to kill one player, and they couldn't kill Flipstip. And they almost did, but they couldn't kill him. I really thought that with the attack on Norm's base, taking out his factory, I thought that would have been enough to swing it. But yeah, no, I think that Detrino was right that it was the economy that won that. That Norm's economy was still too far ahead.
Mm-hmm. That's definitely it. So I think you're right. I mean, you definitely could have been more efficient early on. I do, however, think... that probably a good option at that point would probably have been to at least push maybe send a worker up to help Flipstip. Just push that a bit faster as well when Norm had the naked expansion. Like, that is a simple, easy option. That would have been much better.
Yeah, I think Norm's play was very inefficient in his unit use, but his macro was good, his expansion was good, and yeah, he won an economy.
Mm-hmm. And now we have Bandit Plains. Yay!
Woohoo!
I like this map, because it's basically Trojan Hills, and I like Trojan Hills. Oh, this map's bigger.
Yeah, this one is more suitable for 2v2, probably.
Oh yeah, far more suitable.
Oh no, wait a minute. This is the small one.
This is the big one. This is 16 by 16.
Oh wait, yeah, you're
Trojan
right.
Trojan is 12 by 12.
Yeah.
It's also known as fewer camera errors, but anyway. So it's really... I like this map. I like both
this
of the maps.
This has very dictated start positions with the 3 mechs clusters. So,
oh yeah, that's true.
There's only so many options. I think
Trojan
that can stabilize the game a little bit more, and it also, I think, heavily encourages airplay because of the defended nature. Whether you put the air player, the big decision here is often whether you put the air player in the crescent.
And not to mention the distance between the metal in the start locations and the next clusters.
Yeah, there's a very long distance, which means that air constructors are often good here just to sneak around the sides and start taking.
Yeah, and it's even more risky to expand against an air player.
Although because you get bombed a lot more easily on the way. Yeah. So we can see Aquanim's already choosing to do it in the corner here, to have Aquanim go air. Google Frog hasn't picked his factory yet.
Although the thing with Google Frog's actually going forward, not even going for the cluster. Not even helping giving that to Aquanim.
That's valid. If he can push really far forward and take the middle of the map really early on, that could work for him.
Although that's tricky, but yes, that was about to say that Trojan Hills does provide a lot more flexibility when it comes to that, because in Trojan, you don't have two sets of three, you have three sets of three.
Mm.
But on Bandit Plains, the southwest and northeast they get rid of the set of three in order to make this ramp area here, or this raised area.
Yep, so this is gonna be a Flipstep versus Aquanim game on the air. And they've chosen conventional start positions, but they've chosen to have Flipstep
forward.
Yeah, this is Norm versus Aquanim in the air. They're choosing to have Flipstep start in the corner, though, which means that he's going to have a much harder time expanding. So this is all going to be about where the Google Frog can push through the middle and take a lot of territory quickly, and what happens in the air with the air versus air game.
Mm-hmm. Although we saw the last time that Norm is a little bit too overconfident, or can be overconfident. They may have learned from that first game, but we do see that Norm is very anxious to get the bombers out and starts just counter expand, and I don't know if that'll happen this time, especially with the glaives coming out. That's going to be a lot of pressure to build up phoenixes, to build up ravens, possibly. Definitely phoenixes.
Yeah,
though.
Norm is building a raven next.
Said, super anxious to get ravens while Aquanim's going for the hawks.
Yeah.
Has the swifts.
You're spot on.
So I guess Norm did not learn anything from game one, because that did not go well that time.
They did manage to scout Google Frog, but Google Frog's already managed to push into the middle, and there are some scorches pumping down here, but he's probably going to do a similar thing with his sort of holding using ticks. Yeah, he has a tick in production. He's holding using ticks and glaives just to try and take territory using that versus scorches, which is a pretty good choice.
Yeah, and the thing is the scorchers are probably... The thing is they have to deal with the commander. The commander is forward. The commander has not morphed, though, and one or two more scorchers could dive it successfully. And if they do that, I think that would completely cripple Google Frog. Google Frog has no builders in the moment. They have
ticks on the
blade.
Way now. Yeah, he's going to need
the window's
three
over.
Scorches. The ticks on the way and the window's closed, yeah.
Darn. And they can still put some harassment here and there, but not the same. Not at all the same.
That tick can just have a guard order on the commander and just follow it around everywhere it wants to.
Hasn't done that, though, surprisingly.
Yeah, I think he's keeping it
perfectly valid.
That's... very important for
although it looks
Ukrainian
like it's not
to
matter.
Keep those aircraft close to that commander in the center.
Synergy. We are seeing the synergy again with the Scorchers and the Ravens.
Let's see if he can stun out the Ravens. No,
Scorchers are stunned out. So is Google Frog's commander, though, but the Ravens are not stunned out.
Oh, this is...
One of the Swifts, however... Oh, Norm Swift, my mistake. One of Norm Swifts was stunned out. But it looks like one last Scorcher going to try to get in, but gets blocked out by our Swift wreckage. Stopping from being
able
to catch
up
Google Frog's commander. They might.
There's another tick. It needs to get in position.
And it's... Oh, it's going to... I think it's going to do so. Yes, it's going to do so.
Yep.
Just barely. But Google Frog's commander... Oh, nice use.
Oh, perfect.
Oh, nice Scorcher micro there from Flipstep. That's exactly what we needed to see for Flipstep. And Google Frog loses their commander. Massive loss for Flipstep on the ground. But I think that was worth it. Like three Scorchers,
four commanders.
That
was really, really tense. Excellent tick usage. Excellent. I mean, Norm's greediness paid off in this case. Even though he's losing his ravens. I think that paid off because Google Frog relied heavily on that.
The hawks are getting air control back, and then
Now
with Google Frog's losing in their commander, that basically nullifies the entire effect of the expansion.
You might notice that Aquanim has stopped production for quite a while now and has been giving all resources to Google for a minute or so.
Oh, I hadn't actually noticed that. But that is good to point out.
But what they really need is energy at this point.
Yeah.
But if
they just lost +6 with the commander.
Yeah, they lost plus six. They lost plus four metal. I mean, they're just behind overall. Flipsip and Norm are ahead by about five metal. And energy is even. Energy is high enough for all players to sustain what they're doing. But being ahead by five metal, that's going to be a big deal. That's half a factory right there.
Google Frog's managed to expand backwards to the original quote-unquote start position.
Yeah, and he also has a nice...
defenses, yeah, which they is have, good.
Okay, Google Frog's expanded there, but not to the southwest, and there is a dart just in case. So when there is... There are builders going in here. Actually, there's a conjurer coming in right here, and a dart's already in position. Flipsip's already prepped for this. And the north side, that's getting pushed in. The center's getting attacked. There's a naked expand, or partially naked expand, with a repair pad coming from Norm in the south, in the northeast side of the map. And the southeast side, we have the crane. So Aquanim is going for the crane once again.
I wonder if it would be possible to make a third factory or a second factory for Flipstip.
Yeah, he can afford it.
Because that vehicle factory is so far back. It takes so much time for those units to get into a fight.
Yeah, Flipstip should probably build it, I'd say, behind, like, on the west side of the hill that Flipstip's commander's on right now. Build a caretaker, build a factory, and stop production in their main base. Oh yeah, that would work too.
Although what Norm's doing instead is he's investing even more heavily in air. He's building an air repair pad up on the high ground there, which means that he's going to be spamming a lot of bombers. He's made the choice here to not go for a land factory. You're building an air repair pad, you're choosing to go heavy into air.
Although that does also help the Hawks, and that's a big deal because that gives the air control that's needed.
Yeah, I didn't consider that repairing Hawks is also a good utility of that, yeah. But I think that if you're going to invest in that, you want to be using a lot of Ravens, otherwise
definitely. That's the main point. It's just that because of the Hawks there, that's the only reason that Norm even has air control left. And if they're able to get through the Swifts, take out a few Swifts here and there, keep the Hawks alive, especially by repairing, that just makes it even easier. Keep it going from that. Don't have to build Hawks, just have to repair them all the time. Build Ravens. I mean, Aquanim is building more and more Hawks, so this is going to be tricky to sustain. And it's already... Well, it looks like one Hawk down for Aquanim so far. Yeah, one Hawk's down for Aquanim. A second Hawk just gone down as well. Wow, Flipstep completely for free taking air control, and they can repair these Hawks. Actually, they need to repair these Hawks. This Hawk has to move back. In fact, one of them is going to go down because it didn't move back if it keeps going forward. And over the northwest... We have another meetup. It looks like Google Frog hitting Flipstep's naked expansion, or nearly naked expansion. Bit of a problem. These Hawks are not doing much except scouting. And it's not a bad idea, but at this point, it's a little unnecessary. And it looks like Flipstep calling for a Phoenix over to the southwest side of the map in order to not die. And that's not going to happen.
They've really, with those Hawks, he's managed to fully rest to air control, which means he can fully invest into it, build more bombers. While Aquanim's giving up,
Phoenix.
He's going tank factory.
And there is actually an emergency tank. Phoenix, but that's not going to be super relevant. It's going to help a bit. But yeah, tank factory is... Where is the tank factory? Oh, I see what you mean. Yes, there is... Wait, no, I don't.
A nice dart.
Aquanim's going for tank factory. That's why I'm looking.
Yep, Aquanim.
The dart can morph to a scorcher.
In the corner, too.
Yeah, that dart's finally paid off. It was good just to leave it there on those metal reactors and wait for them to be expanded to. Because even though the front is now completely defended...
We haven't had a stable in a month and a half. That's why I'm thinking. I thought morphs were removed. You know, they're removed in test.
Yeah. We have glaives coming through, and they're really sweeping out the middle, but they're going to run with the commander here, and this is a morphed commander, which should be able to take down.
They did hit the Lotus. The only reason the commander's alive is because that Lotus was there. And even then, the commander is barely alive. Very
close.
Come
the Sith, the trademark move from Google Frog.
Yeah, that commander's down. Although it's close, but now the commander's going down, and Flipstep loses their commander, evening things out slightly, but even then, at this point, the blue team has taken the entire north side of the map. Google Frog, still not even able to take the south side of the map. That dark
Google Frog needs
Scorcher.
To get some constructors into the middle of the map and start reclaiming this, because that's two commander wrecks now, which haven't been touched, as well as the armies.
Yeah, but it looks like the Scorchers are going to be able to take out these glaives without too much issue, and then of course air control is entirely in the hands of Norm. I mean... They have not seeded it at all. I mean, these Hawks are still alive. The Hawks have been undamaged. They've been taking out...
I think this factory by Norm in the top right corner is a bit odd.
Yeah, it's a cloakabout factory. What does that do in there? That is bizarre.
Not that it's odd that it's built there.
Dart in the southwest was destroyed. Should have become a Scorcher. But oh well.
Yeah. I think that Akronyms at this point is resorting to building flax in order to try and displace these gunships, because this is, you know, all he has left is to build ground AA.
Yeah,
I think Google Frog will be able to stabilize, and he's building warriors now and forcing them through, which will allow him to take territory and start reclaiming, which is what he really needs to do.
Although,
but the fact that Norm has taken such strong control of the air puts him in a very dangerous position.
Yeah, because Norm has the warriors. Flipstep went for slashers. Really good move there. Very good choice.
The Tlek truck, well, it's good AA.
Yeah, that's... But
no,
then,
the good AA gets bombed.
Yeah, that's the problem. Good AA gets bombed.
Oh, no, he's going
and
for the commander.
Akronym's commander goes down. Second commander down, but that's a lot of Ravens that went down. And the Hawks also going down. Oh, on top of the flak, that's a huge problem. These Hawks need to retreat.
I'm not sure if that's what they're worth, actually.
No, it wasn't. At this point, Akronym has just gotten, not gotten air control back, but they have an opening. They have a window to get air control back. And the center being attacked, the slashers are doing a decent job, but actually, yeah, decent job. Getting rid of one of the warriors. The second warrior is going to go down pretty quick. It has to be forced back. But why are these Hawks attacking? The Hawks should not attack. Nice shot in the wind gens, I'll give that. But still, the Hawks should not be attacking. Actually, really nice shot in the wind gens. Akronym lost a lot of their energy income from that. But now Akronym has air control. Akronym has retaken air control.
After having lost the commander, that's really, really dangerous. But the thing is that Akronym now has five Panthers. That's enough to completely clear out this expansion, possibly even snipe the commander, and definitely take out the air repair pad. If he just pushes through this...
In the top right, you mean?
Yes.
Norm's commander, yeah.
Yeah, Norm's basic commander with the sides.
I don't see any point of moving there with the Panthers.
Well, one of them is going over there already.
Yeah. But the problem is, four of these Panthers, he's taking them to the middle, he's only sending one to raid. I think he could do more economic damage with these than he should be defending in the middle. The middle's kind of static at this point, especially with those ticks here, which really prevent Flipstep from advancing anymore. These Panthers would be much more better offensively, and they're getting bombed.
And the Copperhead's nowhere near them, too. So despite the lack of air control, Norm is still managing to keep in. It looks like Norm didn't really actually lose air control that much, because Akronym hasn't been investing that heavily into air.
But he got rid of the Air Force, which is still very important.
That's true. But there are still enough Ravens that's a problem. And the Scythes are in as well, just to get rid of the Panthers, because why not? Yeah, the Scythes get rid of the Panther, no problem. So that one Panther does nothing, and the remaining Panthers are in the bad spot of the map. They do know, but there's only like one or two more Panthers in play? Like, I don't know. It doesn't seem like there's that many Panthers in play. There's a few being repaired in Google Frog's base, but that's... That's at the center of the map. That's way out of position.
Those Scythes are really dangerous. You can see that Norm... There was a window there where the Panthers could have cleaned Norm out, but Norm has now fully gotten his factory up and running.
Yeah. Scythes being pushed out. Warriors Glaives being pushed out. Everything being pushed out. Well, Glaives and Scythes primarily. And then the reclaim in the center. The Comrex not reclaimed yet. And there are Conquerors trying to take it on both sides.
Google Frog has started spamming out a lot of Roccos, which very strong offensive force in this situation.
Yeah, and the Napalm Bombers aren't really in play. They're kind of dead, aren't they?
Here come the Scythes.
Yeah, and not the best position.
Spotted.
Got spotted, needs to get out of there, and unfortunately... there we go.
Where
nice.
Where are they?
What? Oh no, Norm is going to go back. I mean, I can totally see the motivation for this, but he's trying to double back, trying to juke them out, but it wasn't quite the right choice. Not the right position to do that in.
Really good communication between Google Frog and Akronym, where Akronym's like, I don't have any cheap units, I need cheap units to screen, and Google Frog sends back a perfect amount of glaives, splits them up, moves them alongside with the Panthers, and deals with what could have been a devastating attack, which would have lost Akronym his entire economy in both
these
factories.
That would have been game, that would have been match, that would have been Flipstep and Norm on the finals.
That was beautiful. I think that has stabilized the game as long as Norm can rebuild his economy from here, because he still has his commander dead, which is still, and he has two wind generators and two solar collectors is his entire wind energy economy.
Yeah, Akronym is
a lot of it's depending on Google right now.
And Google even then is still behind. I mean, they're both behind economically. It's the military that's kind of keeping them in. It's the type advantage, really. That's the thing that's been keeping them in so far. Is they've just not been... no one's been able to really break them. They've been able to stay alive. Anytime any attacks come in, there haven't been any economical attacks that have actually done the damage that needs to be done. But now Glaive's coming in against the Panthers, although they are getting stunned out because of the Panther tick effect, but even with that, that's definitely cost-effective.
Well, if he gets it, that is.
Yeah, but there's also more scythes coming in on top of that. I mean, it's scythe panther. Well, sorry, scythe glaive. So more scythes coming
died
in.
To missile turrets on the left.
Yeah, and the scythe, four more scythes coming in to take out Aquanum's base, and there's nothing to defend this time round.
Nope.
So persistence will pay off in this case. Nothing to defend, nothing to spot even. Aquanum's completely open. I don't think they expected that they'd be getting regular scythe attacks, because normally that doesn't happen.
Yeah, none of these kind of numbers. One scythe you can tend to deal with. I mean, if he had a Keys Commander up, it might be in a better position, but then scythes can snipe a commander as well.
Yeah, as
you
saw earlier.
You need a lot of laser towers in your base to deal with something like this, or a lot of raiders.
And there's only one race. No, it's two lotuses, and that's the first. No, it's not even the first target. The scythes don't even care. They're scouting out. Good, nice, well done, Norm. Scouting out first. I like to see that. Yeah, so Norm wisely scouting, figuring out where to go, getting the air factory. First.
Yes.
No, getting spotted by the air factory.
Peekaboo.
Yeah, getting the caretaker first. That's a better option.
This is what would have happened the first time. This is what they just prevented, yeah. But they only stalled it slightly and cost a bit of resources. Hopefully the Reaper can clear this up.
The Reaper won't do much. They're going to play around the Rosie, and that'll just kill. I mean, they're going to die to the factory death. Or one of them, two of them dies to the factory death. But still, that's the heavy tank factory. That's all the Panthers and Reapers that cannot happen anymore. Like, no production from there. Google Frog can still push this in, and Aquanum will probably want to push that. Google Frog getting the heavy tank. Aquanum probably will want to donate resources as much as possible. Just try to stabilize. They are getting air, though. Getting a Vulture. Wow, you don't see that in high-level games.
Google Frog needs to be spending sending some reclaimers out into the middle of the map because he still hasn't taken all of his commander wreck. There's 3K metal in the middle, and finally, Flipstep sent 3 constructors out here, and he started to reclaim his own commander wreck.
Had the constructors in the center for a while. They just haven't gotten the commander quite yet.
Yeah, they've started reclaiming now. They're finally.
Yeah, they've got the commander, and at the same time, we have a bunch of glaives tried to get in the southeast, failed to do so. The center of the map. It looks like this is going to be it for Google Frog and Aquanum. There's not much they really have to survive against this. And I mean, the Vulture was a good idea. I can see where that's coming from because they want to see what's happening. Although, is that
I think this Reaper and this Zeus, if they can get something done, they might be able to take this out, take out the constructors, get the reclaim for themselves, and stabilize.
There was no Vulture. Never mind. It was built, partially built, but it never got completed. So I forgot what I said about the Vulture because it doesn't exist anymore.
No, he managed to take care of the heavy laser tower, but he pulled his Reaper back and he lost it. That's the Reaper down.
Totally not worth it.
He almost managed to do it, but the second Reaper is now under attack by Scorchers.
There is a Vulture up for Aquanum, and that's. I can see why they're doing that, but now they're seeing how screwed they are. Like, how behind they are right now. And it's so terribly behind, it's kind of sad.
Yeah, the air control is now firmly in favor of Norm. As well as having a really strong land force right now. And there's more scythes coming through the back to finish up the
effect. Yeah, those constant scythe attacks, that has really been doing it for the end game here.
Yeah, Flipstip's managed to really stall Google out. I think it's the that combined Scorcher Raven attack.
Yeah, killing the con early on. When you take out a 30 opponent's economy, that is a big deal.
Far bigger deal than Google Frogs. Google Frogs, taking out Google Frogs commander, managed to stall him enough that they could then allow Norm to really focus down Aquanim and beat up on Aquanim while Flipstip just solidified that advantage against Google Frog.
Actually, a really good point because earlier on in the second game, they were talking about focusing down Aquanim. That's the big thing they need to do is focus on Aquanim, take Aquanim out. Now, Flipstip and Norm go on to the finals. Congratulations. But they're focusing on taking out Aquanim first, which makes perfect sense because Aquanim is the weaker player. So take Aquanim out, just put all the pressure on Aquanim, force Aquanim to kind of capitulate, and then once that's done, Google Frog doesn't really have much to work with.
I think there are problems with that, though. I think there are problems with the plan, because if you focus too much on Aquanim and you let Google Frog take the whole of the rest of the map, he's much more efficient with his resources.
True.
Whereas if you what one thing you can do is you can snipe, you can even cheese Google Frog, kill his commander, really early and leave Aquanim at a comparative advantage.
And that's what we saw.
He's not going to be as effective. Yeah, which is what we saw. But then they could stall because it's very hard to kill Google Frog entirely. They just knock Google Frog back and they stall. Flipstep built up a big defensive base there. He built up, the heavy laser tower. He got his commander into a good position while Norm really wrested air control from Aquanim.
Mm-hmm. And that was good that Norm did that. That was the one thing that differentiated this in the first game, was the air control. The fact that Norm built this air repair pad, and the fact that the Hawks could survive, the fact that they got enough Hawks that they were able to keep in, but also keep their Hawks alive rather than the Hawks going into battle and then getting gradually worn down. Norm didn't allow that to happen. Or they did in a couple cases. They made a mistake once with the Copperheads, but earlier on when it was really important, they didn't make any errors when it came to the use of Hawks, especially with the air repair pad.
That was a really interesting choice. I think on the whole, though, they won on getting more territory and then getting more economy, because they used their units very inefficiently at certain points. And Google Frog and Aquanim played a very sort of solid style, excellent unit choice, you know, excellent sort of transition into tanks and all these sorts of things. And even, you know, the flat Copperhead just made so much value. But in the end, Norman Flipstep could have absorbed that because they had so much territory and so much economy behind it. And they had such better energy economy is one of the big things, too. It's you can't underestimate that because...
Aquanim was getting blocked out by energy near the end. For the last several minutes. After losing the napalm bomb on that wind farm just killed Aquanim.
Yeah, there was a huge line of completely unmolested wind generators for Flipstep out the back there, which were actually providing overdrive. So, their economy was just more robust in every way.
Mm-hmm.